So, as the name or title itself indicates, anti means something which is against the nutrients, something which doesn't make the nutrients available in our body. So, in the body, in the foods, as a natural mechanism to fight against the odds, environmental odds, the nature has provided the nutrients which are anti to human, but then they provide some good effect to the plants. So generally, so studying or more recently, food scientists, technologies, people are trying to look at the nutrients and how one can make the bioavailability of those nutrients at the maximum percentage. Because you know, whether you take an example of India or any country, we have surplus amount of food. And we know that this food is very, very essential part of our lives. But at the same time, it is very unfortunate fact that India, being one of the topmost country in facing malnutrition, and there are other countries like low developing countries, LDCs, wherein a severe malnutrition can be seen. And if you see, there are so many fruits, vegetables, grains, pulses, wheat grains at one side, they go waste, okay, because of whatever reason. But then there are two things, like one is malnutrition and there is a hunger. So there are hunger related diseases, and there are you will be surprised to know that over 60% of the death in the world are due to malnutrition and hunger related diseases. So when as a scientist, when we want to remove the malnutrition or hunger, eradicate hunger, you must be knowing that sustainable development goals, so UNESCO or worldwide various organization have a focus target and sustainable development goal. There are 17, 18 sustainable development goal in which the hunger, poverty is and good health are topmost three SDGs, which needs to be, you know, eradicated. So scientists across the globe are trying to eliminate hunger and malnutrition, and removal of these anti-nutrients is one way to make the bioavailability of the nutrients more, so that, you know, for example, proteins are not bioavailable, or vitamins or other nutrients are not bioavailable, or carbohydrate are not bioavailable. So they will not provide you know, sufficient nutrition. So one, if one knows what are those anti-nutrients and how one can remove it completely without causing any loss on the nutrients, it will be helpful. So anti-nutritional factors are nothing but they are the compounds or the constituents or the substances present in the natural food, or they could be sometimes synthetic origin also. Sometimes, you know, people add different grains which are not edible, or stones that are present, or iron particles, or whatever it could be. So they could be either natural origin or they could be synthetic origin. But today in our class, we are going to discuss natural origin, but there are synthetic which will be covered in adulteration. Okay. So these substances which are added or present naturally, they will interfere with the absorption of the nutrients. Okay. There are example of synthetic origin also, the drugs. Okay. Sometimes when the person is sick, the person will take to get cure eat nutrients, but at the same time, there are certain drugs which will interfere with the bioavailability of certain nutrients. We have seen also in some of the vitamins. That some of the vitamins will interact with the drugs, okay. So, and thus those vitamins are made unavailable. So they are like synthetic origin, but they are anti-nutritional, okay. So these anti-nutritional factor will interfere with the absorption of these nutrients, and they will thus reduce the nutrient intake, or they will affect on digestion, or there will be less utilization. And then it is, if a person doesn't stop consumption, it may result into an adverse effect or adverse health implication. Okay. So mostly there are plant-based anti-nutritional factors, and generally anti-nutritional factors and their effects are seen generally Those who eat only raw or vegan, you will be surprised to know that there is a one community in the world who will not eat the food at all, like processed food. They will eat only raw, like everything in the raw condition, fruits raw, vegetable raw, nothing, no cooking, no processing, no nothing. So there is a one community who will only consume raw, or there is only community who will only strictly consume vegan with some, you know, restrictions. And so therefore, these anti-nutritional health implications are seen into those people. Okay, so the common symptoms that are seen because of this consumption of anti-nutritional factors are like it can be nausea, it can be bloating, headaches, rashes, nutritional deficiencies, and so also because, as I mentioned, these are generally plant origin, and they are there in the plants as their own defense mechanism to fight the odd or environmental odds, to protect themselves from the environmental odd. However, there is a good news. Good news is that if you perform adequate food processing, it can remove the anti-nutritional factors. Okay. So these are secondary metabolites acting as anti-nutrients. Can be removed by various ways. We will see, and we all know that there are certain grains like beans, legumes, nuts, certain leaves, roots, tubers, fruits, and their concentration can vary. We will see in detail. So mostly the major anti-nutrients found, as I mentioned before, raw fruits or raw plant-based foods. Okay, so for example, phytates, tannins, lectins, oxalates. Okay, so these anti-nutrients that are present in vegetables or could be in whole grain like wheat along with the bran, or rice along with the bran, legumes along with the husk, nuts, etc., like almonds, you know, so therefore soaking of almonds and consuming them may give an extra added benefit. Okay, so that can really help. So only when a person diet is composed exclusively of a raw plant food, then you see the more implication. So oxalate, for instance, you know, prevents calcium from being absorbed, and oxalate is present in, you know, that aluvadi, colocasia, very very high concentration of oxalate is present. If you consume that, you know, fresh leaves of aluvadi or colocasia, you will find that tingling or oxalate taste in the mouth. The raw spinach, kale, broccoli, soya beans, they usually contain a very very high amount of oxalate, but we generally do not consume anything that is raw. So when one consumes excessive amount of these anti-nutritional factors, including tannin, which are associated with, for example, tea, consuming a lot of tea or consuming a lot of wine or some fruits, raw fruits, like for example blackberries or black grapes, or too much of dark chocolate. Basically the enzymes that are responsible for protein absorption, they completely get inactivated. So it becomes literally very difficult. Phytates that are present in grains, nuts, as I said, almonds, and there are other nuts, seeds like pumpkin seeds and other seeds. Okay, wild peppers, eggplants, tomatoes also contain lectins, is an anti-nutritional factor. Phytates consumption may lead to a lower mineral absorption, and lectins are able to cause various reactions to the body. Saponin, on the other hand, have been linked to red blood cells, damaging enzyme inhibition and thyroid function intervention. So let us start one by one, what are the different anti-nutritional factors, and through various food processing, how one can remove. So if you see this picture, the red beans or white peas or chickpeas, various types of beans and seeds, or white butter or white peas, is very commonly consumed, at least in India, because mostly you see people are vegetarian. So they have this in the diet, and these contain a very high concentration of lectins. So basically, lectins are defined as the proteins. Basically, they are also proteins, but these are the lectins that are present in these beans, and they are proteins that binds to the carbohydrate. So your carbohydrate will be not available. So you know that carbohydrate is the most staple, like we consume chapati or we consume rice or we consume many other food, like even fruits or veg, whatever source. You see, carbohydrate content consumption is very, very high. So this may cause problems during human digestion. So basically what these lectins do, they resist being broken down into the gut and are stable in acidic environments, and they feature that they protect lectin containing plants in nature. Okay, so basically they present naturally present in these beans. So when a person consumes lectin in their active state means not you know, when you cook it, it becomes deactivated. So active form, when a person consumes them, suppose you consume raw peas, okay, or raw beans, active state can cause negative side effects. Severe reaction in people eating even small amount of raw kidney beans are observed. So these lectins are associated with, you know, they also contain phytohemagglutinin, a type of lectin, and that can cause red blood cell to clump together, and which is not very good. It can also produce nausea, vomiting, stomach upset, diarrhea, and bloating and gas is a very common. Like if you eat chickpeas a lot, raw maybe, so you may find that bloating and gas. So basically, overall, lectins are abundantly present in the plants, and they have this ability, as I said, they bind with the carbohydrate, and also sometimes there are proteins that are like attached along with the carbohydrate. So glycoprotein, glycolipids, or polysaccharide, and so they have basically variety of role. They can bypass human defense system, they can travel all over the body, they can cause, you know, over consumption of these lectin may result into Crohn's disease or celiac screw or colitis, and they can break down the surface of the small intestine. When the large quantity of lectins are introduced into the body, the gut wall develops the hole, and also the intestinal permeability can be, you know, affected, which can cause the leaky gut syndrome. So this is very important, but at the same time there are few papers wherein these lectins are being used in prevention of diabetes, because these lectins can make cells act as if they have been stimulated by insulin, or they can cause insulin release by the pancreas. So those insulin dependent diabetes, there are two types of diabetes, okay, type 1. So in the case wherein insulin dependent diabetes, this lectin consumption have been proven really good. So this lectin can also cause autoimmune disease by presenting wrong immune system codes and thus stimulating the growth of some white blood cells. There are reports wherein this lectin have been found to cause cancer, and although there is a lot of research going on, and not all variety of lectins are toxic, but definitely they are responsible for intestinal damage. So what are the sources of the food that are present, this lectin present in? Wheat, so whole wheat. So we never consume raw wheat, okay. So we either cook it or we make the flour, we make chapati, we consume it. So consuming raw chapati may be also disadvantageous. Beans, consuming raw beans, quinoa, peas, etc. So grains are very, very common part of the bird's diet, but you see that birds have these themselves are resistant to grain lectins and they can't digest it. The adverse effect of this consumption of too much of lectin results into inflammation, migraines, joint pain, acne, And lectins are usually found in hull, so choosing white rice can lower the lectin instead of brown rice, or heating the plant sources in the process of cooking. Like, for example, if you have beans, so remove the outer covering of the beans and then consume it, okay? Or you soak it or cook it. White potatoes, for instance, have a higher lectin content compared to sweet potato. Almonds are also resources of these lectins than even peanuts. So how to reduce lectins? The best way is, you see this water is become yellow in color or brown in color. So these all anti-nutritional factors, they get leached out. So cooking especially with wet or high heat methods like boiling, stewing, soaking for several hours can definitely inactivate these lectins. So because they come out, because these lectins are water soluble and they can also found on the outer surfaces of the food. So exposure of water or soaking for long can definitely remove. There are papers, research paper, wherein germination is a very, very helpful. This germination and soaking or cooking or pressure cooking can definitely remove these lectins. Okay. Canned beans are cooked and packaged in liquid, so they are also low in lectins. Raw beans simmered at low heat, such as in a slow cooker or undercooking, the beans will not remove all the lectins. So there have been, you know, lot of studies wherein different cooking methods have been performed with respect to these lectin containing beans, peas, lentils, soya bean, chickpea, fava bean, etc. Okay, so there are other ways like to deactivate these lectins, like sprouting. Also fermentation has been carried out. In addition to that, there are few research papers in which these lectins have been used in a lot of good things. Like if you see, this is the cancer biomarker. It can be also used in targeted drug delivery. It can be used in autophagy, immunomodulation. As I said, white blood cells are produced. It can also be used in cancer prevention. So lectins can act as an antioxidant, which can protect cells from the damage caused by the free radical. They can also slow down the digestion and then absorption of carbohydrate, and they can be useful in the diabetic people. Also, there are research papers and use of this non-toxic low amount of certain lectin to stimulate the gut cell growth in patients who are unable to eat for a long period, and in also in anti-cancer treatment, this has been used. So these lectins have shown a good effect, like they can be used in prevention of cancer. Lectin containing foods like legumes, whole grain, nuts, they are associated with lower rates of cardiovascular diseases. Some of these lectins have shown cholesterol lowering effect, and they have helped in weight loss, type 2 diabetes. And also it has been found that these foods are rich sources of B vitamins, proteins, fibers, minerals, and healthy fats. So the health benefits of consuming these foods are like far outweigh the potential harmful effects of the lectins. And as I said, there are ways to remove the lectins. Okay, so the next and nutritional factor is your protease inhibitor. So protease as such inhibitor means the one that inhibits the protease enzyme. So protease inhibitors are widely distributed again in the plant, including seeds of legumes and cereals origin, and they are most commonly encountered class of anti-nutritional factors of plant origin, and they have ability to inhibit the activity of proteolytic enzymes within the gastrointestinal tract of animal. And because these are protein in nature, they can be easily denatured by the heat. That's a good news. Okay, so although some residual activity may still remain in the commercial produced products, and these anti-nutrient activity of protease inhibitor is associated with the growth inhibition or pancreatic hypertrophy. Okay, so there are lower incidences of pancreatic cancer have been observed in population where more see, soybean is one of the largest source of this intake of soybean, and the soybean contains a really very high amount of protease inhibitor and may also act as an anti-carcinogenic agent. Then Baumann-Birch inhibitors derived from soybean have been shown to inhibit or prevent the development of chemically induced cancer. So there are certain good benefits also for this anti-nutritional factor. This was a concept once upon a time, but nowadays we call polyphenol, tannin, but anything in excess is bad for health. So under protease inhibitor only you have this trypsin inhibitor. So if you see, this trypsin inhibitor and chymotrypsin inhibitors are the protease inhibitors which are present basically in the legumes. And these trypsin inhibitor that inhibit the activity of the enzyme, especially the trypsin. We know that trypsin and chymotrypsin enzymes are needed for the digestion of the protein. So for example, if this yellow color is your protein, so what happens, these like these are the inhibitors, like suppose these are the serone protease inhibitor. So they binds with your enzyme, and then they cannot, you know, act onto the protein, and thus the protein remains undigested because you need enzyme to digest the protein. So but these enzymes are inhibited. Okay, so they are like, see, they are blocking the way. So these trypsin inhibitors that inhibit the activity of enzyme trypsin and chymotrypsin in the gut, and therefore there is no digestion of the protein takes place. Okay, mainly the grain legumes like white pea, chickpeas. So trypsin inhibitors are unique class of these proteins that are found in. So these trypsin inhibitors are unique class of proteins that are found in raw soybean that inhibit protease enzymes in the digestive tract by forming indigestible complexes with the dietary protein. So basically they form the complexes, and therefore these are not available. Okay. So mostly if you see, they are found in wide range of foods like chickpeas, soya beans, red kidney beans. Although we say that, you know, there is a very, very high amount of protein, more than 40% of the protein are seen in all these beans, like mung beans, adzuki beans, or red kidney beans, and etc. So these are, they contain these, but then, and we know that 10% of world's dietary protein is derived from grain legume. Animal source protein is so expensive. But then because of the presence of this trypsin inhibitor, it is not available. Okay. So there is a huge burden of the protein. We see mostly for all these anti-nutritional factors, the therapy or the ways to remove these anti-nutritional factors are very, very similar. So that is why I have added at the end of the session a separate section on removal of these anti-nutritional factors. Then the our saga of anti-nutritional factor continues, and the next anti-nutritional factor is alpha amylase inhibitor. Again, it is an enzyme inhibitor. We know that amylase enzyme are needed for the digestion of the carbohydrate. Okay, so if you have inhibition of alpha amylase, is considered a strategy for the treatment of lot of disorder related to carbohydrate. Okay, and therefore in diabetes, by reducing insulin level as well as dental caries and periodontal diseases, lot of therapies, alpha amylase inhibitors are being used. So these are basically substances that bind to the enzyme alpha amylases, okay, making them inactive. So there are two roles of alpha amylase inhibitors. They have been identified. The primary function of inhibitor is protecting the seed against microorganism and pest. As I said, this is a natural mechanism, and the other function is the inhibition of action of endogenous alpha amylase. We know that suppose you have any seed, okay, take an example of chickpea or white pea. So there is almost 50 to 60% of the starch and also alpha amylase. So if there is no alpha amylase inhibitor, what will happen? The alpha amylase enzyme itself that is present, even in the wheat there is lot of alpha amylase present. So that alpha amylase itself will act on the amylose is a constituent of the starch, and then it will degrade. So the grains will spoil. So therefore this is a natural mechanism. Okay, so the instability of this inhibitor under the condition of gastrointestinal tract, and it is being a very, very heat labile. Okay, the moment you put cook the legumes, it's highly sensitive to heat. So it is used to control, therefore it is used in control of human diabetes type 2 and find several applications in the food industry. So if you look at this table gives you an idea. There are different sources of legumes and fruits and vegetable in which different anti-nutritional factors have been observed. For example, legumes, and in legumes if you take very commonly consumed legumes like soya, lentil, or chickpeas, or peanuts, or beans, you will find that they are rich in phytic acid, saponin, cyanide, tannins, trypsin inhibitor. So all sort of anti-nutritional factors are abundantly present in these legumes. So if you soak it, the amount may vary from legume to legume. Like soybean is very, very high in trypsin inhibitor. Or phytic acid content in these legumes is really, really very high. In 100 gram, you will find that almost 400 to 700 milligram of this phytic acid is present. Or cyanide also may range from 2 to 18 milligram. Grains that are very commonly consumed, such as wheat, rye, oat, millets, corn, and other grains, kodo millets or other underutilized millets, they are rich in oxalates and phytic acid, and the level may vary from 50 to 270 milligram per 100 gram. Okay, pseudo grains, as I said, newly quinoa, amaranth, buckwheat, teff have come into existence and people are consuming, but they were not consumed traditionally because of their high tannin content or lectin content or high phytic acid or goitrogens content. Nuts like almonds, hazelnuts, cashew nuts, pista, Brazilian nuts, walnuts, and other nuts are also rich in lectins, oxalate, and phytic acid. Sesame seeds, flax seeds, poppy seeds, sunflower, pumpkin seeds also contain a high amount of alpha amylase inhibitor, phytic acid, and cyanide. Cyanide may vary from 140 to 370 ppm. So therefore, if you consume, a lot of pumpkin seed, you will feel like very dizzy or drowsy because of the high cyanide content. And therefore, raw pumpkin seeds Here in India, not very common, in China and some Western country, the sunflower seeds, raw sunflower seeds, are very commonly consumed, or just roasting of the sunflower seeds can be consumed. Tubers like carrot, sweet potato, Jerusalem artichoke, manioc or tapioca or yam also contains a very high amount. Except for carrot and sweet potato, we do not consume any of these as such raw. Either we cook it or fry it, or we cook it and then we consume. And also tomatoes, potato also contain some of these anti-nutritional factors. To continue with the anti-nutritional factors, the next anti-nutritional content is tannin. Very often you take an example of pomegranate, fruits, berries, your day-to-day lives, chocolate, tea, or your blue grapes or blueberries, you will see that these tannins are distributed. So, but then these nowadays plant tannins are antioxidant polyphenols. They are found in wide range of food, beverages like tea, coffee, and their role in the human health, like multifunctional role in the human health, have attracted attention of all the food scientists all across the research scientists, because nobody wants the medicine. Suppose if I consume everyday green tea to reduce the cholesterol instead of consuming tablets, it's always a very good way. So tannins are oligomers of flavanols and flavan 3,4-diols, and they are concentrated into the bran fraction of the legumes, also certain cereals. So grapes, green tea, they are very rich in these water-soluble polyphenols. So therefore, tannins exhibit a very good anti-nutritional property by impairing the digestion of various nutrients. For example, tannin binds with calcium, iron, and they bind it, and then they can also shrink the protein. They can make the minerals by unavailable. Some of the proteins, they can be made unavailable. So these tannin protein complexes or tannin mineral complexes can not be digestible, or they cannot be absorbed. Okay. Phytates. Phytates occurs in several vegetable products like seeds, grains, nuts, legumes. They all store phosphorus as a phytic acid in their husk, but generally we remove the husk, except for like almond if you consume, or hazelnut if you consume. We consume along with the husk. Okay. So this husk in the form of phytin or phytate salt, these phytates are present, and their presence may affect the bioavailability of mineral. As I said, iron bioavailability or iron calcium is reduced. Their solubility of some of the minerals, functionality, digestibility of protein, carbohydrate, because these phytates bind with protein, forms the complex or precipitates and carbohydrate precipitates, and therefore these are not digestible. So phytic acid is most concentrated into bran of cereal grains. So in legumes, this phytic acid is found in cotyledon layer, and that can be removed prior to consumption. So basically, the digestive enzyme phytase can be unlocked, the phosphorus stored as phytic acid, and in the absence of this phytase, phytic acid can impede the absorption of other minerals like iron, zinc, magnesium, and calcium by binding to them. And this into a highly insoluble salts that are poorly absorbed by the gastrointestinal tract, which leads to the lowering bioavailability of the minerals. Okay, so therefore phytates can also inhibit the digestive enzyme, not only iron, mineral, calcium, but also the digestive enzyme like pepsin, trypsin, amylase, and the carbohydrate and proteins are not digested. Goitrogens are like anti-nutritional factors which cause hypothyroidism. So this hypothyroidism is increasing daily worldwide, as the thyroid gland is highly sensitive to stress. So if you see, a lot of stress is increased, and also there are environmental factors that affecting the lifestyle is changing. A lot of things are happening, and the big example is this COVID pandemic, and mental disorders are on rise in the entire globe. So because of this, this thyroid gland is highly sensitive to this stress. So if in addition to that, if you consume goitrogen, so these goitrogen interfere with the iodine uptake, and therefore it affects the thyroid of function. We have seen, we have not seen, but maybe in the minerals chapter, in either nutrition or in the chemistry of constituent, you must have studied these iodine. So iodine plays a very, very important role in the goitrogen, okay, thyroid function. So vegetable from the brassica family like broccoli, cabbage, cauliflower, Brussels sprouts, kale are some of the goitrogen-rich foods. Although we never consume them raw, we cook them and consume. So consumption of these cruciferous vegetables affects triiodothyronine, that is T3, and thyroxine, that is T4 level. And these T3 and T4 levels are directly involved in the function of iodine, which also influences the function of these thyroid glands. Okay, so when the level of these compounds is affected due to the more consumption of this cruciferous family, it may result into hypothyroidism. So concomitantly, there are other factors that can be also influenced. For example, if a person is not consuming sufficient amount of water and there is already a protein malnutrition. Raffinose oligosaccharides are most commonly, found in various, again, legumes and plants. But recently, these oligosaccharides have been considered as good prebiotic because they are not digestible and they go enter into the small intestine where they promote the growth of probiotic. Okay, they are fermented there, and butyric acid and other good short chain fatty acids are produced, which enhances the growth of good bacteria. So raffinose, stachyose, verbascose are all part of these raffinose family oligosaccharides, and they are synthesized from the glucose. Non-digestible oligosaccharides have a prebiotic effect, and that is why, there are many multinational companies who are trying to either isolate these or using fermentative production, using the bacteria. These can be produced in a laboratory. So basically, these oligosaccharides have a prebiotic effect in the lower intestine, and that promotes the growth of probiotic, that is bifidobacterium and lactobacilli, and that can inhibit the growth of pathogenic bacteria, thus building immunity. So the absence of appropriate enzyme activity to hydrolyze these raffinose oligosaccharide, like this alpha-galactosidase enzyme, that leads to inability of humans to digest these raffinose oligosaccharide, and therefore it can allow them to pass through the intestinal wall intact. A correlation between legume consumption and the likelihood of this intestinal discomfort has been drawn, leading to symptoms like burping, abdominal pain, bloating. It's very common, if you consume a lot of these legumes, you will find these problems most oftenly. So this is because of the raffinose oligosaccharide. So these interfere with the digestion and digestion of the nutrients. Okay, these raffinose oligosaccharide can also reduce metabolizable energy, protein utilization. So therefore, it is can be also used in weight reduction and other good health benefits. Saponins, like if you see chickpea, broad bean, lentils, soybean, garden peas or mutton or white peas, that can they are very, very rich sources of saponins. So some saponins like steroid or triterpene glycoside compounds, they can be used for food while others are toxic. Okay, so they saponins are basically bitter in taste, and they are toxic in a very high concentration. Therefore, they can inhibit the absorption by absorbing by inhibiting the enzymes like digestive enzyme. Also, it can also bind with the nutrients such as zinc. We have seen zinc is very, very important in various metabolic reaction or various other helpful or important functions in the body. So saponins are naturally occurring substances with various biological effects. and in the presence of cholesterol, saponin exhibits strong hypocholesterolemic effect. So it's a good way in a small quantity. They can also lead to hypoglycemia, or that can impair the protein digestion, uptake vitamin, mineral, and that can lead to the development of a leaky gut. But this happens if the excess consumption of saponins are considered. Okay. Oxalates. Some organic acids can have these oxalates, like oxalic acid can form soluble or insoluble salts. For example, sodium, potassium soluble salts, or insoluble like calcium, magnesium, iron, or esters called as an oxalate, and they are commonly found in your spinach or palak, or they can be synthesized in the body. So insoluble salts cannot be processed out of the urinary tract. So they are then processed through the digestive system. So this calcium oxalate can have a very, very detrimental effect on human nutrition because it can cause kidney stone. Okay. So kale, radishes, cauliflower, broccoli, colocasia, they are very, very high in your oxalic acid. Parsley, beetroots, rhubarb, black pepper, chocolates, of course dark chocolates, nuts, berries such as blueberries, blackberries, beans, and some of the foods like colocasia is really high in oxalic acid. Okay. Exorphins, the alcohol soluble proteins like proalamines of cereal grains, dairy products called gliadin. So like you know, wheat has this gliadin, glutelin and gliadin together they form gluten. And there are other also like oat also has this. So can be further degraded to a collection of opioid-like polypeptides. They are called as exorphins in the gastrointestinal tract, and behavioral traits such as spontaneous behavior, memory, pain perception, they can be severely affected by the bioactivity of these exorphins. So exorphins can also influence gastric emptying, intestinal transit time by increasing its time, like constipation. The digestion of milk produces alpha casein derived exorphins. So there are a lot of research going on. This is not a very well studied topic, but recent research suggests that this epigenetic effect of milk derived opiate peptides may contribute to this gastrointestinal dysfunction and inflammation, and that is why, you know, gluten free concept, people want more gluten free food and things like that because of the exorphins. So there are certain contextual anti-nutrients. They are nothing but like basically some supplements or food rich in certain nutrients, but they can create reaction of an anti-nutrient nature. For example, calcium rich food can impair the iron absorption. So if you consume too much of calcium, okay. So there is also a mutual antagonism between zinc and copper during absorption process. Phytosterol, phospholipids, both of they can reduce cholesterol absorption when added to non-fat foods. Very interesting. There is also a lot of reports are there on food drug interaction. For example, grapefruit consumption is like avoided in variety of drugs because this grapefruit has this bergamotin, and that can inactivate a lot of drug and their metabolizing enzyme. This is the reason why food interaction warnings are listed on some of the medical labels. So when one is taking any medication, one has to be careful while looking at the label. Resveratrol, which is found in grapes or red wine or peanuts, that inhibits the platelet aggregation, and high intake of this resveratrol may cause increased risk of bleeding when consumed with the anticoagulant drugs. Okay. Black tea was more powerful enzyme inhibitor than single ingredient of the herbal tea. So herbal tea has a lot of ingredients. So compared to a single ingredient, black tea was very, very powerful. Okay, because it is an extract of tannin. Foods containing tyramine, like chocolate, beer, wine, avocado, has a lot of tyramine. And monoamine oxidase inhibitor, it is a type of antidepressant. So, also broccoli, spinach containing high vitamin K, and the coumarin, which is present in anticoagulant medicine, can prevent the clots or thin the blood. So, as a scientist or food technologist, it is our duty to look how can we remove these anti-nutrients, because we saw that they are very, very rich in protein content. Okay, so for example, you have this phytic acid, phenolic compound, saponin, lectin, semaglutinin. So they have adverse effect, but there is also good news that they can be removed because they are highly heat sensitive, they are water soluble, and so soaking, cooking, germination, fermentation, irradiation, roasting, flaking can definitely remove this. So soaking, there are numerous research papers wherein soaking can be seen as one of the easiest physical process to remove the anti-nutritional factor. So soaking in distilled water, and if you add this soda and mixed salt solution, that can reduce even a greater extent of these anti-nutritional factors. Okay, like tannins, phytates, they can be reduced up to 20 to 40%. Soaking decreases the total protein, soluble sugars, tannins in the soybean flour. So soybean flour was soaked, and it was observed that the protein was decreased soluble because of the leaching. Soaking and sprouting grains, like sprouting is very, very commonly used. Fermentation has been known traditionally, because we know that fermentation, there are bacteria, good bacteria like acidophiles, lactobacilli. So if you ferment, for example, fermenting a grain flour for 24 hours, and that is why, you know, fermented probiotic drinks are again becoming more famous based on cereal grains, wherein there is an anti-nutritional factor reduction is happening. So a lot of these phytic acid and polyphenol content were reduced because of the fermentation performed by Lactobacillus acidophilus on the grain flour. Entire anti-nutrient properties reduction were observed in soybean for a 1 day of fermentation at 37 degrees Celsius. Hydrogen cyanide, oxalate, and phytates were removed from cowpea due to the fermentation. Okay, trypsin inhibitor was also significantly reduced, like almost 70%. Protease inhibitor 30%, phytate 60% was observed when 120 hours fermentation with Lactobacilli plantarum was done on sorghum flour. Germination again is one of the most effective way for the reduction of anti-nutritional factors, like phytate levels are reduced drastically, trypsin inhibitor activity, amylase inhibitor activity, phytase content, tannin content of soybean when they were sprouted were decreased. A lower anti-nutrient level of germinated amaranth seeds were recorded. Germination leads to increase, and we know that germination has a lot of advantages. A good enzyme gets activated, like for example, amylase gets activated, and then it acts on the complex carbohydrate, and they get converted into sugar, like maltose is produced, dextrins are produced, and proteases gets activated due to germination, and they act on proteins, and then amino acids are released, then peptides are released, which has a health promoting effect. Heating. So cooking or heating whole grains, beans, vegetable can definitely reduce certain anti-nutritional factors such as phytic acid, tannins, oxalic acid. There were reports wherein protease inhibitors were easily denatured due to heat treatment, and because this protease inhibitor is a protein, anti-nutrient level were reduced with controlled heating at a temperature less than even boiling for at least 15 minutes. Autoclaving or pressure cooking has also shown a significant reduction of hydrogen cyanide, phytic acid, trypsin inhibitor, oligosaccharide. There were reports wherein cooking sweet potato leaves with lemon reduced polyphenol with 56% and lowered the oxalate levels. Groundnut seeds, like boiling a babara groundnut seeds, a variety, for a period of 60 minutes significantly lowered the raffinose oligosaccharide, and it also improved the digestibility. There were reports wherein, you know, cold pasteurization or gamma irradiation was shown very, very effective to reduce the level of trypsin inhibitor, phytic acid and oligosaccharide. Not much, but between 5 to 10%. So low doses of gamma irradiation, like 0.5 and 1 kilogray on faba beans were studied, and there was a significant reduction in anti-nutritional factor such as tannin and phytic acid in these faba beans were observed. In addition to that, scientists are also working on genome technology. So this can be used as pathways to RNA interference or DNA interference, which can remove the anti-nutritional factor itself in the beans. You see the green peas. Now a variety of green peas is available wherein they are more sweeter. Or carrot. There are varieties of carrots which are more sweeter and more sugary. Corn, there are two white varieties of corn. One is very, very sweet, sugary, and one is no sugary. So with this genomic technology, I think there are ways. And in one of the papers published by Shukla et al., they designed zinc finger nucleases construct to mutate the gene from the base called as IPK1. And one of the phytic acid biosynthesis genes, because corn contains a very high amount of this phosphorus stored in the form of phytic acid, and they were successful in developing the variety with a low level of phosphorus. Okay, so this genome editing technology can definitely increase the crop quality, but then a lot of, you know, people are discussing whether to use genetically modified food or genetically treated food. So debate is going on, but obviously one day will come where people will accept. So in conclusion, anti-nutritional factors, they are widespread food compounds that are especially challenging for those choosing a predominantly plant diet, for example vegetarian or vegan. So all these legumes are contains high amount of these anti-nutritional factor, but at the same time in a small quantity they also exhibit beneficial health benefits, and these anti-nutrition may induce their undesirable effects when they consumed in a very, very high concentration. So thus presence of lectins, tannins, alkaloids, saponin, chitrogen inhibitors, etc. in food may induce various reaction when the consumer is presented with little knowledge. So detoxification can be done through various food processing ways. So with